Okay. Hi, good morning. Welcome to this the panel of how to strike a balance and align your community work with your employer's objectives. And I think this is a very needed to be discussed topic. And hopefully we can, you know, make this panel very productive. The goal is to build awareness and then also find solutions for everyone. And I think most of you have heard of or used the tool, Stylitics tool. And it's a, did I say it right? Stylitics tool, right? And this is a tool to show contributions from various employers and then developers. And from that tool, you'll notice that there's this 20-80 rule. So 80% of the code are actually contributed by 20% of the contributing companies. So this is how OpenStack is very different from like Linux Foundation open source project. And because OpenStack is very much driven by or supported by vendors. And so this is the saying, you know, like you want to dance like nobody's watching or work like you don't need the money. I'm still working on that. I can dance like nobody's watching, but so far I'm still working towards like working like you don't need the money. and so unfortunately, most of us have a boss, have an employer. And the best situation is you can work on something you love to do and get paid. And your employers are very happy with your contribution. But from an employer's standpoint, they invest a lot in OpenStack because they believe in OpenStack. However, they do have their own business objectives they have to meet because they have boards, they have their, you know, executives that they have to and customers they have to report to. So there are some, you know, different perspective in working in the OpenStack space. So today we would like to discuss that. And before we start the panel, I'd like to just to see how many of you are developers and how many of you are managers? Or if you are managers, you don't feel like raising your hand. I understand. Okay, how many of you are developers? Great. And how many of you are managers? Oh, good, good, good. I'm so happy.
And
yeah.
How many of you are
both.
Other.
Other or both, right? I mean, both. So, okay, so that's great. And so we're going to start this panel, and I'm very honored to be here on stage with all these esteemed panelists. And I'm sure these guys, you guys probably know them already. They don't need introduction, but still, I'm going to, because we're recording, so I'm still going to have them introduce themselves. And let's start with Arkady.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Arkady Kanevsky, and I'm from Dell. And I am the Dell Gold member for the Foundation Board and also in charge of the Dell OpenStack solution.
My name is Mike. I primarily have been focusing in block storage area. Some of you might have heard of a thing called Ceph, and so working on that initially before another project called Cinder that before it even existed, and Nova Volume worked on that driver. But on top of that, it was previously PTL for the Cinder and the Liberty and Kilo release, and then I am currently a TC member at this point. And I work at the OpenStack Foundation, focusing on cross-project initiatives to help with all those consistency woes.
I'm John Callahan. I'm with Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. My primary role with OpenStack is the application ecosystem working group and also the enterprise working group. So that's my primary focus at this time.
I'm Rochelle Grover. Most of you guys, if you know me as Rocky. I'm with Huawei R&D Labs in Santa Clara, and my job is pretty much undefined other than provide value to the company with regards to OpenStack and help them get more value out of it.
Nice. I'm Monty Taylor. You may know me on IRC as Mordred, and if you don't, you should get on IRC. I work on the OpenStack infrastructure program and other things, sit on the TC and the board, and work for IBM where I lead a team called the OpenStack Innovation Team? Innovation? OpenStack Innovation? Something, I don't know. Like we innovate all the things, all the time.
I believe your bio also included of creating the initial launchpad OpenStack.
Yeah. So if you... I guess in the grand scheme of everybody claiming to be a founder of OpenStack, I do at least have one. If you go to launchpad.net/OpenStack, it actually does say created by Monty Taylor.
So Monty Taylor created OpenStack news.
Yeah, I think these guys are very humble, actually. You know, they actually have been very successful contributing to the OpenStack community. We have TC here, we have PTL, we have board members here. So, you know, they definitely have been doing contributing a lot to the community. And they are very successful doing their own job for their own company. And my name is Annie Lai. I work for Huawei IT product line strategy and business development. And I used to be a developer. Now I focus more on the business side. And in the OpenStack community, I'm currently representing Huawei's Gold membership. I'm a board member as well. And also, I participate in various work groups. So without further ado, Arkady actually has prepared a small presentation for us, just to kind of set the stage before our discussion today. So it's going to be about 5 minutes, and then he's going to talk about the various different objectives from the developers and then employers when it comes to contributing to OpenStack.
Thank you. So first and foremost, I would like to emphasize that you know, the whole topic of this discussion, thanks for any organizing that, is that there is kind of a goals and objectives for us as a community creating the open source platform for the cloud. But it does not mean that every company who's participating in that has the same goal. And that's expected. If they're all having the same goals, you know, you will not be successful because everybody have to, you know, be identical. There is very little differentiation. But the goal of the OpenStack itself, as you know, foundation is driving that, is that, you know, we wanted to provide stable APIs. We wanted to provide a stable implementation which you can use, and you can you know, accelerate of your development of the cloud and developing the application and value proposition on top of that. So the, you know, there is a fairly remarkable recognition when you are a member of the OpenStack, and especially if you your contribution are highly valued, both as individual contributor as well as a representative of your company. But from the company perspective, I mean, you know, they're not altruistic. They have, you know, they have to one way or another show a return on investment, whatever that means. So they need to, you know, balancing out, you know, what the resources they contribute. And when I say contribute resources, this is basically time of all of us working upstream in the community to improving the OpenStack itself. But at the end of the day, you know, they need to show some results coming out of that. And it's usually in kind of in a variety of the forms, depending upon what your company, you know, goals are. You know, it could be that, you know, your hardware could be integrated better with OpenStack. It could be that you develop some application on top of that to make, you know, to make the delivery of what software you're developing faster and easier, and a variety of other different ways. But the whole purpose why the people go to the OpenStack, so they have, you know, tremendous speed to market. They have a recognition for the customers because customers already know what OpenStack is, so it's much easier for them to absorb it when you have, you know, your call it solutions, you know, interacting or properly integrated with an OpenStack. So the thing I would like to kind of stress that in most the hardest part, which usually don't involve any of us, but you know, involved what we call corporate strategies, is to define how the company is going to benefit from participating in OpenStack. What is the thing that they will develop either upstream as part of the OpenStack or add on which differentiate them in some form or shape, and what they're going to, you know, be able to deliver. Again, the fundamental thing is you know, all of the products are, you have to face, you know, concentrate on what the customer requirements are and make sure you can meet them. You know, OpenStack have no shortage of the things which customer are required but not capable of delivering yet. So there is a lot of what I would call short-term opportunities for the companies to benefit from. But, you know, as everybody expects, sooner or later those holes will be filled. Thank God, so not, you don't have to have your own specialized things to deal with that. So you have to have a value proposition which will, you know, have a longer term. Now, with respect to you as individual contributor to OpenStack, that's a very delicate balancing act. First and foremost, if you do not believe in your corporate strategy of how to utilize OpenStack, tough. There is no simple way of saying it, because basically what you are saying is that while you love to do the work you're doing and contributing to the OpenStack and making it much better, you don't see how the current strategy which your company has really working. You know, depending upon your company culture, you might have be able to provide a feedback to that or raise your voice, but that's from company to company specific things. A lot of the people are willing to do stuff on their own accord, and that's great. There are individual contributors that don't associate with the company, and you can certainly do that even when you work for the company. But do mindful that one way or another, you still represent, you still work for the company, and you did sign some legal agreement when you joined the company. So be careful. Okay? So on top of what, you contributing your time, which, you have to balance between the time you have for the, work for the company versus if you decided to freelance with OpenStack, be mindful that, we are, your activities in the social environment, which is OpenStack, one way or another reflects, the company for which you're working, because you're representing them. As Annie pointed out, the Stackalytic kind of gives you all sorts of information of how individual contributors in the company contributes to, but it kind of shows some social stuff, but a lot more shown not on the Stackalytic, but in all of the tweet and everything else which is happening around. So that's kind of my main thing, is be aware and be mindful, to don't overstep the legal boundaries which are between you and your employer.
I'd like to add a thing there too, because there's a really interesting. I wind up talking about turns out political science more than tech a lot of when talking about OpenStack these days. But it's worth pointing out that as much as that's absolutely right, there's another option as well, which is if you don't agree with the. One of the nice things about empowering developers is that in this particular case, if you are working for an employer and you don't agree with what they're doing, there's a bunch of companies here that have different strategies. There's a bunch of different strategies, and it's you can deal with this in a couple ways. You can just work for your employer and do things in the evenings or weekends if you don't agree. You can also move somewhere else, right? You can find the employer that you do agree with their strategy, right? And it does resonate with you, so that some of these balancing act problems and some of these having to be careful, you have to be less careful. Like, you can honestly, earnestly, of your own free will, say, yeah, no, I am gonna go do that, not just because somebody told me to, but because I think it's a good idea. It's like you're sort of voting with your feet as it is. And so I think it's always worth pointing out that you have that, and at the moment there are no shortage of companies who need people doing OpenStack things.
But I'd also like to add that I would challenge you to be the change agent in your company. Mm-hmm. Now, there are some things that you can't deal with, and if there's an ethics problem, get the hell out. But be the change agent, and don't be afraid to go for it, to be disruptive, because like Monty said, somebody else will hire you in a New York second.
Yeah.
I'd like to add to that. I mean, we work in the open source community, and we're like, hey, a lot of times I tell people, open source developers are like artists, right? You're idealistic, you have this dream, and you really want to make it happen. So it's important to be true to yourself. Sometimes just a paycheck, I understand it's important to have that paycheck, but if you cannot be true to yourself, then you're going to feel very painful to keep working in that environment.
Something that I once heard from the OpenStack release manager, Doug Hellman, at one point, he was basically linking over Twitter, like, to this article, I'm not going to name the company, that just basically, you know, gave up on OpenStack, was invested so much money. But the one thing that he took from that article was, how much did they actually invest in their employees to allow the company to be successful? And I think when you look at all like the super users, and you talk to those large companies, it's amazing that how happy that their contributors are, their employees are. I mean, being around in the community for a while, I mean, listening to people, I mean, it's black and white there. So,
mm-hmm. I'd like to just say, in my case, I'm part of the non-coding groups. And a large part of what I'm doing back into my organization is really kind of informing them of the fact that we do have this action that's going on. We're recruiting a lot of the new developers to OpenStack. And it's a matter of getting some of our development people involved and bringing out some of their experience in being able to attract some of the new developers and providing them with the tools that they need so that they can get involved. And so as I've just recently changed management, the person that I was working with previously was had a lot of OpenStack experience. And 2 weeks ago, I found out that he was going to be moving to another division. I have a brand new manager, and all of a sudden he's going about learning more about OpenStack, and so he's supportive, but I have to inform him mm-hmm. now what this is all about. So it's a little, it gets to be a little bit more of an educational format back to the organization that you're working within. You just really never know where you are sometimes, and as I think you educate them, they see the benefit, but back into the company. And we can also benefit from the company to the OpenStack group. So that's what has worked well for me.
Mm-hmm. Real quick non sequitur. Guess which ones up here are the developers?
Yeah. What are you saying that that there's that you can tell by looking and stuff?
About what you're wearing. Or by hairdo.
I don't claim to be a developer.
Okay, so
I want to just add a couple of small things. So as Monty pointed out, there is no shortage of companies who, you know, are doing the development of OpenStack, and finding the company, which matches your desire of the outcome of the OpenStack is not that hard. So the other thing I want to mention is that within your own company, find who is that person who is driving the strategy and who is putting together how the investment and how all of the contribution which you're all doing for the company and OpenStack really resonates. Because providing the more feedback to that person, making his job a little bit easier, will benefit you directly. So the other thing I want to point out, companies are kind of top-down entity. The OpenStack is bottom-up entity, as all of the open source communities are. Mm-hmm. And the innovation comes from the bottom, not from the top. So if you have an idea, don't be shy to bring it forward. And it will be surprising to you how it might benefit your own company by you bringing that idea forward.
Yeah, that's actually, I think, the root at some of the problems and some of, why we're sort of on this topic is, companies are very used to a top-down command and control structure and saying, oh, well, it's really this product feature we've planned for our big, corporate event, then we're going to make an announcement and we've got to deliver it. And so we're going to ask everybody to, pull all-nighters, and which, by the way, if any of you are managers, that's a counterproductive strategy. All of the research basically says that. So if you ever have the urge to say, just work a little harder, can you guys work a weekend? It's you're being a bad manager. In any case, this is how stuff is. People are used to working, and that doesn't is very ineffective with OpenStack to have somebody come in and say, well, my boss told me that I have to get this patch landed today. And we say, well, the patch doesn't work. And so, well, but you know, I have to get it landed because it's my business objective. And I'm like, I don't care. It doesn't work. And that's certainly a friction point. And it involves some communication and education that has nothing to do with the technology itself in both directions, right? Communicating back up the chain, you know, like talking to the strategists and getting people to understand that predicting when a feature is going to land is pretty impossible. Predicting that a bunch of features are going to land is a guaranteed, that is definitely going to happen. So figuring out how the corporate strategy and marketing departments and everything can ride that wave and use that as a value rather than a thing they're working against is a way that all of us that are in the trenches on the developer side can be really useful to the company to remind people that, well, maybe you shouldn't announce 4 months ahead of time that you're going to release something because you have no way of promising that. But you can change your marketing strategy. You can change how you think about communicating with your customers right. about the value that they are going to receive in 4 months. We all know that in 6 months from now, there is going to be another release of OpenStack, and it's going to have a bunch more stuff in it. What that stuff is, no idea.
I just want to say, as being a former PTL, I've been pulled into very shady random hotel meeting rooms where there is lots of drinks and food being provided, and hey, we just want to have a quick conversation with you about our agenda. It doesn't work, but thanks for the beer.
So it's actually a very good conversation here because, you know, a lot of us, we have this dilemma. We want to create and then we want to follow the foundations, you know, policies and all that. And then also at the same time, your employers have, expectations. So what happens if, you know, the project that your employees are very interested in are not accepted by, for example, Big Ten, right? What do you do? Maybe some of the panelists can share with us, you know, the strategy to deal with that kind of situation so you don't get fired if you don't do the job. But at the same time, you can effectively kind of influence your employers to, you know, to act correctly.
There's a definition of suffering, which is that suffering is the divergence between your expected outcome and reality. And that a way to reduce suffering in your life is to learn to not pre-expect what's going to happen today, but to in fact live in the moment and learn to treat reality as it actually is, rather than how you wish that it were. So I think that actually some of what I'm suggesting is that you have deep religious conversations with the leaders at your companies to get them to embrace trying to reduce their own suffering.
Namaste. Okay.
Also along those lines, at least some companies, right now OpenStack is like the center of buzzword bingo. OpenStack and containers. And in the networking side, we all know about NFV of various flavors. And I think one of the things that if your employer really wants something in OpenStack that's open source that they want to be proud of and kind of put their stamp on, educate them that everything doesn't have to have an OpenStack stamp. If you open source it and build a community around that, that can be as good, sometimes even better, for the company. I'd like to just point out Walmart's OneOps is an amazing open source software package. And there are others out there that companies have put out there where they have built software around OpenStack, but they haven't felt the need to actually get the OpenStack Big Tent. So let them know it's an option and let them know that open source in general is really good. It doesn't have to be OpenStack.
I think with regard to Hewlett-Packard Enterprise, we're in a constant state of development, and we're seeing all sorts of changes going on into the future. We have acquisitions that come and support OpenStack directly. We have open source support throughout the organization. And we have the Helion OpenStack initiatives that we've been supporting for some time with the releases that we have that are pure OpenStack support. I think that there will be a lot of changes that go forward as we ebb and flow and change with our with the acquisitions and how they're positioned in the future. As far as OpenStack and the support, I previously was at Walmart and saw exactly how that was used, how OpenStack was supported. And it's different for every company, and it's different for every time, and as live for the moment, as Monty was talking about it. I think you really have to live for the moment, realize that your organization is going to have different requirements at different times, and you have to make the right combination of that software that's supporting what you need to be doing, driving forward, based on what your networking situations are and what your apps are calling out for as well at the same time. So that's my take on it.
The thing that just popped into my head, and I'll apologize, I tend to talk a lot, is there's another thing to communicate up and out as you chat with people, which is when we talk about investment, when we talk about the investment that the company is going to make to deliver on their goals, it's really important for your employers, your bosses, your managers to understand that there's a lead time, there's an investment that is going to have to be made, and it's just a fact of life. Like, you can argue that it shouldn't be this way, but it is. So just accepting it and moving on is really the best thing. You're gonna bringing in new developers who haven't been working on anything to get product features done. And if they're a rock star, maybe in 6 months they might make enough progress in the community to be able to start to move their own agendas. It's probably going to be more like 9 to 12 months. So you've got to be thinking about long-term planning in terms of giving people the time and space to get plugged in enough so that having conversations about, oh, well, my employer has this special thing, like, it's really important to us that, you know, that Nova can be purple, you know, and you're like, okay, that I don't even know what that means. That makes no sense. But oh, we can talk about it. If you walk in first day and you're like, dude, I really need purple VMs, we're gonna be like, you're crazy, and we don't want to talk to you ever again because that doesn't make sense. And a really good way to do that, and this is another important thing for communication, is step one for new people is coming in and working on other people's problems, right? It's coming in and helping with, there are plenty, as we said earlier, there are plenty of problems already. We're already working on things, right? What we don't need is new problems. That's not really particularly welcome right now, because there's things that we've been working on for 3, 4, 5 years that we need to finish off. So the new companies have come in, the ones that have been the most successful in eventually achieving their business goals are the ones that started from a place of showing up and saying, how can I help? What are you working on now that I can help with? And then they work on those things for a period of time. And then eventually they're like, great. Oh, well, I've also got this thing. And then you're like, because you've become a part of the team now. And so now adding your voice and your requirements to the mix is welcome, right? Because you're a valued member of the organization. And that's a thing I think a lot of companies miss sometimes. They get really eager and they get really excited, which is great. Be excited, but like, temper that excitement with some expectations of, you know, there's 2,500 developers here. They're all working all the time right now. They need help on clearing their existing things before they can think about new work. You know, and that's another thing. So.
And along those same lines, it's good to remind your employer that when they first hired you, did they expect you to hit the ground running and be immediately productive on their huge monolithic code base? Most employers actually a lot of them have like 3-month probation periods, remind them that it's the same way in the open source community. You have to build trust with the people you're working with. So you have to start by learning the code base and attempting to make positive changes in it, just like you would inside the company, but that the visibility is to the outside. And also, because of that, you need to be more visible to your manager to let them know how you're building and moving forward in this process. But remind them that it doesn't work that way in the company. It shouldn't work that way in open source.
Okay. We've spent a lot of time, you know, helping out developers, and I want to make sure that this panel is fair. So for the remaining of the time, I like to help out managers, because I do believe that these old sponsoring companies are, they truly believe in OpenStack. Otherwise, they have would not have spent a lot of money and resources in developing OpenStack. However, there's also a challenge for them, because a lot of company structures, KPIs, they were not built around open source model. So I want to kind of seek, you know, the panelists and then maybe some from the audience, that how we can advise our managers to kind of modify their KPI for employees in order to, you know, to help out, to be fair, and then really be productive for the development of OpenStack and for the benefit of their own company.
So I have a really specific couple small, and it's not quite on the KPIs thing, but it's, I hopefully gets there. Advice for the managers in the room, and I've worked for more than one person in my time with OpenStack, and this has gone better or worse depending on who the person is. I highly recommend if you as a manager of people who are working on OpenStack are not on IRC, if you have not learned that, do it. Right? It's not that hard. It's a chat system. So if you can't figure out being on IRC, then maybe finding a shift into the marketing org or something might be
and we also helped improve for onboarding for IRC too. There's like pictures and step by step for Windows, Mac, and Linux. Yeah. So
we've got that, but it's really, that is where OpenStack happens. And if that seems like a scary world off into, like, it's like the dark place where the, you know, where there's like demons and whatnot going, then developing KPIs, developing ways to assess what people are doing is gonna seem very opaque, right? Mm-hmm. And all of this happens in the open. It just may not happen in the way that you're used to consuming. You can log on a really easy one that some people like. IRC Cloud is a web-based persistent connection, so you can, it sort of feels like Slack or HipChat in those sorts of ways. Get yourself an IRC Cloud account, join some of the channels that your employees are in, and learn how those employees are chatting with each other, but also how they're chatting with their teammates that don't work for your company. Because that's the other thing that's missed a lot of times in tracking this work, is that your employees aren't the only ones working on your issues, mm-hmm. right? And so that your employees' team isn't just the people who also work for you. Your employees' team encompasses people all over the world at many different companies. And that is just the reality that it is. Mm-hmm. You can get to know those other employees too. And not from I want to try and recruit you to work for me. Turns out they're free employees for you, right? They're people that you aren't having to pay out of your budget, and you get to know them collegially. They're not gonna do what you tell them to do. But you can learn to interact with them as humans, right? And then there's a lot of tasks actually in the OpenStack community that you could pitch in on. Bug triage is a thing that a manager is completely able to do and it helps to make your employees more effective at doing their stuff. So there's all sorts of ways that you can become involved that aren't, oh, start going coding. Nah, you're a manager, you don't do that anymore, you know, clearly. Everything, but wait, you have a pointy head and you still code. But yeah, I strongly recommend learning how to read the mailing lists, learning how to get on IRC. Makes a huge step forward in becoming comfortable in figuring out what's going on with that crazy upstream stuff, so that you're not asking your employee to give you a readout every day on what happened. You can follow it yourself.
To add on to what Monty was saying, So as I actually was a former VP at some point, believe it or not, of a really big web hosting company. So the fact that you view like that there are demons there be in IRC is actually just you fearing the truth of where your project is going. That's exactly how I felt as being in that position at one point. I know like Stackalytics was brought up on here, and I actually want to echo Allison Randall specifically on the, she's part of the OpenStack board of directors, and you know, she brings up the fact that, and this goes with also with the discussions that have been, you know, being discussed on the mailing list for development, is Stackalytics is being gamed. So just right, because it's all open source. People know how to, what we're measuring on. People know how to submit up, you know, little patches that here and there and get their numbers up. So I just wanted to add that on to with Monty's point that it, you can't completely rely on that. So that's why you need to be more involved.
Can we stick to KPI issues? Because I really want to find, I really want to get some kind of answers.
Actually, okay. That's,
This is managers wanting things out of open source cats who are going to do something else.
Right, and
we're role playing here.
First things first. Monty said that you can bug triage. Well, you can also code review. How many managers here have been developers before they became managers? You guys know code. You guys know architecture. You can jump in on discussions of how to do, how to implement something, what the design is. There are specifications that are out there. If you don't like the direction of the design and the implementation, jump in and participate. It's a lot easier than actually writing code for OpenStack. But for KPIs, I think managers often get caught between a rock and a hard place, in that even if you understand what your developers are doing and are fully bought into open source, the problem is that you have to educate your managers about things like, if you have a product that includes this open source, you have to allow your developers to upstream bug fixes and other issues. This has to be part of your KPI. Why? Because if you don't upstream, your code base diverges. Your code base diverges, you have support issues. You have to have more support people on your team. It costs you more money not to upstream. And this is what the managers have to point out to their managers, that not allowing the time it takes to get the code in the code base is costing your company lots of money. The PKI should be, is the company code base converging with the open source code base? If you can prove a trend of convergence, that means your support costs go down and you're doing a good job. These are the kind of measurements that should be in your KPI.
Yeah, that's a really good, go ahead. I've been talking a lot.
So just want to add a couple of small things. So first of all, as a manager, I mean, you hired the people who, you know, either know how to do open source work already, or you know, interested in, you know, learning how to do it. Trust your workers. Set up what their expectations are, not, you know, in the line of codes or in any of the other measures which are, frankly, completely irrelevant to the end goal, what you're trying to achieve in the solution, but then something which actually, you know, worth measuring. And as properly pointed out, Stackalytics is not one of those measures. A company creating their own project within the OpenStack and bragging about it, well, that's irrelevant. The relevant question is, what is the value to the customer and what does the customer want? Fixing the bug which have been sitting around for, you know, a year, which customer would like to see taken care of, is substantially more productive. Again, you know, as a manager, I mean, yes, you're more than welcome to participate in upstream activities, and it's actually very rewarding, personally. However, trust the people who work for you. They know better what need to be done to make things happen in the community.
That's exactly right on. I think also the trending, looking at trends is a really good thing, especially as opposed to raw numbers. If you've got, you know, bugs and or features that you're interested in, and you're looking at individual employee performance, getting upset at an employee because you assigned them a feature and it didn't land in an OpenStack release is just insane, right? Like, because they do not have control over that. However, as long as you're giving them enough time to actually participate, and I believe that the Thierry's recent stats are those of us that they're sort of actually like in the regular contributor camp are doing at least in the patch a week thing. I would say that really patch a day is probably closer, but if you're not at least in the patch per week, then you're falling off the curve thing. However, that's not when somebody first starts off, that's going to be very different than after they've spent 6 months, after they spent a year. So over time, you should actually start to see your employees have a better track record of fixing bugs and landing features. I don't have any problems in fixing bugs or landing features or getting my patches merged in OpenStack. But I've been around for 6 years, right? I've built up a lot of things. So the one thing where I would say that, looking at the trend over time, are they getting better at getting their goals landed? If they're not, then one of two things has happened. Either you're not giving them enough bandwidth to interface with people, and you should be really honest with yourself about whether you have actually given them enough time to work on things. But the other one is that some people are not effective at working in the community. And that's just a harsh reality. A lot of this open source stuff has to do with interpersonal relationships. It has to do with soft skills in addition to hard skills. Just being an amazing programmer doesn't matter if you can't handle a code review and respond to it, right? Some people just dig in. Somebody tells them something's wrong in their code and they defend their code rather than taking the feedback and moving on with it. So that is a thing to track. And I'm not just going to sit here and say you should let your developers do whatever they want to do. Some of them may not wind up being effective, but tracking that in short term, like single numbers, is unfair to anybody, and it's unreasonable. But you should, if you're giving them enough time, see over time an increase in their ability to react, to participate, to be able to show accomplishments that you could enumerate. And so I think that trending is exceptionally important.
I think we are running out of time. I wish I had more time, but I'm so, like, I think it was a great panel. Let's give a round of applause to our panelists. And they'll be around here, right? And so if you have any questions, I apologize, we didn't have time for you to ask questions. So feel free to ask them, grab them and ask them questions after the session. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.